Awesome day to be alive.
Amen. Yes,
it is. Awesome day to be healthy and well.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord, you bought that too. So this morning we're looking at 1 Corinthians 14. We're going to do part two on that. Last Sunday was the first part of it. This is the second part. This is the main chapter that is usually used to say that speaking in tongues is no longer for today. And we're in the middle of the sub-series. We're doing a huge, big series on the Holy Spirit. Right now we're in the middle of the sub-series dealing with the white elephant in the room, which is, what about speaking in tongues and is that for today, and etc. So we're past the middle. We're coming in towards the end of it. And since 1 Corinthians is a key part of that, we're looking at that and trying to clarify the right and the wrong way to use speaking in tongues in a church or a group setting. And so forth. And since, let me say it this way, I'll introduce what I'm doing later. This is going to be somewhat controversial, what I'm going to say. And if we're not in adult role thinking, this could become offensive. If we're looking to pick up an offense, I'm going to give you a reason this morning. I'll definitely give you something to talk about over lunch. So I think with that all in mind, I'd like to pray and make sure that God's on board. It's his word, so I presume he's on board, but let's just not presume. Lord, we thank you that it's you who speaks to our hearts. It's you who teaches us and leads us and guides us. So we're asking in Jesus' name, Holy Spirit, help us just to approach this with open minds, see what your word says, and take it as a stepping stone to growth, not a reason to get our feelings hung out there or anything like that. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Last Sunday, we found these basic things in the first. We went through about the first 11, 12 verses. The church needs to be edified. When we get together as a group of people, the number one concern Paul had is we need to be edified. It can't come about a certain individual or certain small group of individuals. Everybody needs to get something out of this. Its focus is the chapter 14 is primarily, especially the beginning of it, its focus is on the person who is the speaker. Now, as we get in deeper, he's going to talk to everybody. But what we've looked at so far is he's talking to the person who's the speaker in a church gathering. And he's giving clarification on that. When someone is the speaker, four things need to happen. Revelation needs to be imparted, knowledge, prophecy, word of instruction, something that builds everybody up.
Amen.
And we also discovered point number four, going around and speaking in tongues to each other does not edify the church.
Yep.
So Paul says that's not the best way for a speaker to handle a service, specifically a speaker handling a service, because it's not going to edify everybody. He'll edify himself, but it won't edify everybody else. So that's how far we got. So let's jump in. 1 Corinthians 14:12, so it is with you, since you are eager to have spiritual gifts. See, he realized these people had a zeal. They wanted spiritual gifts, and that's not a bad thing. But keep your head on straight. Try to excel in gifts that build up the church. Remember in verse 1, he told us you need to eagerly desire spiritual gifts. Well, he's kind of revisiting that thought there in verse number 12. You are eager. Let's do this. But again, let's do it the right way. Verse 13, for this reason, anyone who speaks in a tongue should pray that he may interpret what he says. When? When you have the attention of everybody. You're the speaker. Now, that may not just be me. That might be someone else who is speaking, and you get the attention of everybody. You become the speaker. If you speak in tongues, you need to pray you can interpret where? Well, his whole context of this whole chapter is in church. All of chapter 14 is talking about correct handling of things in church, the church setting. So there's a right and a wrong way to do it. Verse 14 and 15, for if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. So what shall I do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will also pray with my mind. I will sing with my spirit, which we did just a little bit of this morning, but I will also sing with my mind. Now, in a church setting, remember, that's what he's talking about. Verse 5, at the end of verse 4 and the end of verse 5, he made it plain. I'm talking about the church. He said, I want everyone to speak in tongues, even in a church setting. But there's a right and a wrong way to do this. That's his point. Now, he just told us something really important here. So if there's a right and a wrong way to do it, what do I do? What shall we do? What shall I do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will also pray with my mind, meaning my understanding. You know, the common language here is English. If we were in Germany, it'd probably be German. We would pray in tongues, but we also pray in German or Russian or whatever the setting is where we're at. He said, I'm going to do both. He said, I'm going to sing songs, and I'll sing with my spirit, but I'm also going to sing in the common language, or I'll sing with my mind, with the understanding. This is not about all or nothing. This is about both in a balance that edifies everybody or helps build up the church. Amen. It's not an all or nothing issue. It can be both. You say, but what about the people who come in who don't understand? Well, let's look at that verse. It's the next verse. If you are praising God with your spirit, which he just said, I'm going to do that in church. But he says, if you are praising God with your spirit, how can anyone who finds himself among those who do not understand, among the inquirers, that's how the NIV renders it, say amen to your thanksgiving or come into agreement with what you're doing, since he does not know what you're saying? You may be giving thanks well enough, but the other man is not edified. So that word understand in the NIV is unlearned in the King James. And the Thompson chain adds in the part there I added into the verse, among the inquirers or people who are asking, they're there seeking, they're trying to find something out. This word is used again twice in verse 23 and verse 24 when he's talking about the congregation speaking in tongues. Not just the speaker, but in verse 23 and 24, he's talking about the congregation speaking in tongues. He uses the same word. Now, here's where I'm going to give you a heads up and have you buckle in. Because the word that the Holy Spirit chose to use here, we have to follow through with me this morning. Because when I mention what this word is, especially if you say, I don't believe in speaking in tongues, especially in church, this word could offend you. But I didn't make this word up. This is the word that's in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. It's in verse number 16, verse 23 and 24. It's used, I think, 6 times throughout the entire New Testament. And it shows up 3 times in this chapter. And I believe that the Holy Spirit, God is really trying to make a point here. Now, I was sitting in my office looking at this because I thought, because it's so touchy, I'll just use that, because it's so touchy, I'm going to have to sit on this for a while to really try to get this out the right way. And I thought if I do that, then we're not going to get to the point of talking about reasons and start the part of, well, why do we need to speak in tongues? What good does it do us anyway? We won't get into why should we speak in tongues? And I sat there and I scratched my head and I looked at that and I laid it to the side and I went and did some other things. I came back, I looked at it again. And the more I looked at it, I thought, you know what? This is no coincidence that God chose to put it in here 3 times. He's trying to make a point. Now, the thing we have to remember is, you say, well, what's the big deal with the word understand or unlearned or even inquire, or someone who's inquiring about something, looking for an answer? What's the big deal with that? That's the English rendering. That's after they translated it. The original word, those are the definitions, but it's not the original word. Now, the thing sometimes we forget is we miss out on some of the things God's really trying to say because we read translations. And I can guarantee you when the translators got to this word, they said, we are not going to translate that literally. Well, in fact, they couldn't, and because it first became, I believe it was in 14, it'll be on one of the screens as we get to it. It was 14, 17 or something like that. It actually became of use in the English language and in other languages, even though it was in Greek earlier. And we've got modern translations that have been translated in the 20th century, and they don't use the original word. It's because the original word is such a strong, you could even say harsh word. And the reason I was sitting scratching my head going, I don't know if I should go over this or not, is because it's so strong and so harsh, But yet, why would God pick something that just kind of reaches out, punches you in the face to explain something? So look at it with me. Try not to get offended if you're in an offensive mood. All of us follow this through because it can throw us into pride too. Like, well, yeah, I believed in it all my life. You know, these people. Let's not go there either, okay? Let's just see what the word has to say and try to see why he said that this way. Okay, Jesus, I prepared him as much as I could. Go back to verse 16. Those who do not understand, how can they say amen? The word we're looking at in the NIV there is understand. Thompson Chain says inquirers. King James says unlearned. You can skip the next one and go to the actual word. Here's the actual word that is used. The idiots. There's the Greek word, idiotes. It means a private person. It's an ignoramus. It's where we get the word idiot from. It means ignorant, rude, or unlearned. And we'll look at all three of those because we'll have to try to understand what's going on here. It comes from a lower word, deeper root word, number 2398. The definition to that is, again, pertaining to yourself or one person, a private, a separate person, someone who's alone, set apart, etc. And that it's going to make sense here in a little bit, but I just wanted you to see it. Now, again, I'm going to restate this because I don't want anybody to get their feelings hurt. I'm not trying to be rude or funny here. This is the word. Look it up in Strong's. You'll see it yourself. Not trying to belittle or put anyone down, because in our culture, the word idiot is a put-down. It's a belittling word. In the original language, in Paul's time, it was not a put-down. In fact, I had said on Wednesday night, some of you who've heard it, you know, we were talking about relating with people and building relationships, and I mentioned that my wife has built a pretty strong relationship with a dead man over the summer. Because of things that she is making sure she's on stable footing with. She spent a lot of time listening to Kenneth Hagin Sr., and she can quote him now. And, you know, I joked, I said, there's sometimes she, you know, when we get together, she said, well, I was talking to Brother Hagin today, and this is what he told me, you know, and it's like, I know what you're saying. You're getting really, you have a personal relationship with this man, at least you feel like you do. And he is totally imparting into your life. I understand that. And then one morning she came out and she said, do you know that Brother Hagin calls people idiots? I'm going, serious? I didn't know that. She said, yeah, but he didn't explain what he meant. He just said, you know, when people think like this, they're idiots. I'm going, wow. Well, then I ran across this because I was curious. What does it mean to be unlearned? And I looked it up and it means to be an idiot. It's like, well, that must have been what he found. In Webster, it means this, a very stupid or foolish person. The full definition from Webster hits it. It's usually an offensive word. It's in a person affected with extreme mental retardation, a foolish or stupid person. Its origin, it comes from a number of different languages there. I've got the Greek origin where we just read from Strong's. Speaks of a person who is a private station, a layman, an ignorant person. Layman, ignorant person is easier to understand. Private station, we'll look at that a little bit more, see what it's trying to say. Back up just a bit, I want to point out that bottom line. This is the first use in, I believe, English language, was the 14th century. So it's not a recent word in English. I mean, it's not an old word in English. It's actually more recent. But in the original, it's kind of old. Private station. Let's look at that first. It's a person of private station. Webster says private. Well, the first three definitions don't really apply. I don't think. You can read them. I don't think they apply. I'll go to the one underline that I think applies. Not known by the public or by other people. I think that applies to our situation and what he's talking about here. So you get a person coming into a church who isn't known by us. He's a stranger. He's a private person. His station explains it a little more. Again, the first two don't really apply, but the bottom one does. A person's social or official position in relation to others. So he's not part of a Pentecostal, charismatic, church. He's a person who is more private when it comes to that sector. He's alone. He doesn't know them. He's not known by our circles. He's a stranger. It'd be another way to say it. He's a stranger coming who doesn't really know what goes on and so forth in a Pentecostal church. In that specific application, Paul is telling them in 1 Corinthians, when you have a person come in who's not officially or in the social position of being part of the church at Corinth, they're not known by you, they don't know you. When it comes to the things of the Spirit moving, the Holy Spirit says they are very ignorant, they're very foolish concerning these, they're stupid, and it calls them an idiot. It's like, whoa, serious? Why? Why would you hit that hard? It used the word, go to the next slide if you would, it used the word ignorant, rude, and unlearned. So the person coming in who doesn't understand things of the Holy Spirit, they're ignorant, they're rude, and they're unlearned. Well, again, rude doesn't mean what it meant back then. So we have to look it up and find what Webster says of some of the old definitions. So ignorant in Webster, I didn't pull everything out. I tried to pull again what applies. Lacking knowledge or information, ignorant, that makes sense, resulting from or showing a lack of knowledge. So people coming in who don't have the information, they don't have the knowledge to understand speaking in tongues. Rude, Webster says this, being in a rough or unfinished state, crude, natural, raw, primitive, undeveloped, elemental, ignorant, unlearned, 2A there is ignorant, unlearned, number 3 definition, marked by or suggestive lack of training or skill, inexperienced. So they're inexperienced, they don't understand it. It's not, wow, you're rude, which means you said something to really hurt somebody's feelings, or you're kind of out there, you didn't guard your mouth, and you just, bah. That's kind of what it means now. Wow, that person's really rude. That's not the old definition. The old definition is they don't know. They're ignorant. They're unlearned. They don't get it. They don't understand it. That's the old definition of rude. That's the one I believe Paul is going into, because he speaks of himself in 2 Corinthians 11:6. Uses the same word. He says, though I be rude in speech, yet not in knowledge, and he goes on talking. Rude in speech means I am not very experienced. I don't have a lot of training or skill. I'm still kind of undeveloped and raw, kind of rough around the edges. He's not saying, when I talk, I'm working at offending everybody, like we would normally say rude means. That's not. He's saying, I don't have the experience. I don't have the training. I'm kind of rude in speech. I'm unlearned. But in knowledge, I've got what it takes. And he goes on talking about that. So I point these definitions out. We got one more, and I want you to really pay attention to them, because they play into the whole point that God's trying to make here. The last one is unlearned. Again, Webster's, I'll go to the last definition there, having or showing very little learning, education, or knowledge. So there's a theme through this. They're inexperienced. They don't know. They're uneducated. They're ignorant. They don't get it. They have no experience with this. They're outside the social circle of this. They're kind of a private person, not understanding this social circle, coming in. Thayer's Greek Lexicon says, an unlearned, illiterate man opposed to the learned or educated. That's that word, idiotes. However, there's another thought that goes in with it, and that's where the Thompson Chain Bible brings that out. This person is not a mocker. They're not a jester. They're not coming to make fun of it. They actually want to learn about it. That's why the NIV added among the inquirers, like it has there in verse number 16. And you'll find that in the Thompson Chain. They add it all the way through 1 Corinthians 14. Every time that word shows up, it says, among the inquirers, among the inquirers. So this is not a mocker. This isn't somebody coming to make fun and just poke at things and tear it down. And that's not their attitude. They just don't know, and possibly have never been exposed to this. So you say, how does this apply? Why would the Holy Spirit pick that word? So again, don't misunderstand me. Stick with me. Follow this through, because I'm not trying to be sarcastic. But this is a pivotal word he's using in this chapter. So why did he use that strong a word? And those people back there understood this was a really strong word. Here is one of the reasons. I'm going to give you a number of points, but here's the most glaring one to me. Why would he do that? For those of you who have ever talked to anyone who does not believe in speaking in tongues for today, and they don't believe it should be here, especially we shouldn't do anything like that in church, etc., and they come with some form of argument or doctrine or whatever, I've had them come to me and say, if I come to your church and then people are speaking in tongues, it does me no good whatsoever. What's happening in church is supposed to edify the people that come, like it says in 1 Corinthians 14. That's why Paul said we shouldn't speak in tongues, which that's a ditch. He didn't say that. But they go there. We shouldn't speak in tongues. So you guys are doctrinally wrong, so I don't want to come to Word of Life. I've had them tell me that. So I agree with what Paul is saying, that it edifies the person, but nowhere does he say you shouldn't do it. That's a stretch on it. So I agree with that. But the word he uses to describe people who are unlearned in the situation where speaking in tongues takes place is where we get that word idiot. So when it comes to these things, when you argue against speaking in tongues, specifically the purpose for or the need for speaking in tongues, you know, I've had so many people tell me, well, not everybody's supposed to speak in tongues. Rubbish. You can't show me that in the Word. And, you know, we've looked at all kinds of things that, well, it's not for today, etc. Rubbish. You can't show that to me in the Word. That's why we're taking so long in this section. So you've got to qualify. But when it comes to these things and people argue against speaking in tongues, when you are a person who says, I am against it, I disagree, I think it's wrong, this shouldn't be happening in church, this is no longer for today, etc., God is literally calling you an idiot. An ignoramus. That's what it says. And like I said, I told you right from the beginning, this could be controversial and some people could get offended. So I'm trying not to present it that way, I'm trying to present it as fact. That's literally what God is calling you. And when you say, I am against it, according to the word he used there, you're admitting you're unlearned, you're ignorant, you're illiterate with these things, having very little education or knowledge in this area. You're lacking information, you're inexperienced. I'm just taking the definitions, I just put them all together. You're lacking information, you're inexperienced, you're simple, you're undeveloped. When it comes to the things of the Spirit, specifically speaking in tongues and how that should work, that's you. And yes, I believe we need to be sensitive to the needs of people and where they're at, and that's why I'm trying to walk through this very carefully, but yet make the point. And we need, as a church, to handle speaking in tongues correctly. Amen. We know God does not use put-downs. God does not belittle someone to try to get them to understand. So he's not using the current, what I call what we'd probably say, well, what does idiot mean in our culture? He's not using that definition. He's reaching back into the old definitions of this word. But yes, he is intentionally trying to make a very strong point here. Yes. To use that, I mean, there's other words that he could have used that mean unlearned. You didn't have to reach for that one. And if you actually believe the scripture is inspired and the Holy Spirit wrote it, God intentionally reached for this word and plugged it right into this chapter three times. Yep. Why would he do that? Well, here's my first point on that. In our efforts to handle this gift correctly, we are not to back off the correct and godly use of tongues, whether it be in private life or in church. And please go back to those old definitions and keep those in mind. But we're not supposed to back off the correct way because, should be the next screen, I think, we are not to back off the correct and godly use of tongues in church because, just because an ignoramus, or what God refers to as an idiot, walks in and disagrees with what we're doing. Well, what if someone comes in and they don't believe and they disagree? Are we supposed to back off? I don't think so, because why did God use that strong a word to describe them? Just saying, just trying to let that soak in, because I know this is a big chunk, like, wow. Yeah, that's why I sat at the desk going, wow. We are not to be affected by their input any more than any other business owner or corporation would be affected if someone who's an idiot walks in and tells them, you're not running your business right. They don't have any experience in the business. They have no training in the business. They have no background in that particular business. They are very unlearned in that particular realm of business. They're simple. They're very rough and raw around the edges when it comes to that business. But they're going to walk in and tell the business owner, yeah, but you're running your business wrong. This is all upside down. The business owner would probably go home and tell his wife, I had an idiot in the store today. You think he's going to change his business because someone who doesn't know what they're talking about came and disagreed with what he's doing? No, he's not going to. So you say, well, why is this important? Because that's what much of the charismatic Pentecostal church has done. We've backed off. There's no longer, I could name churches and churches and churches who are even in our circles, AFCM churches. When some of the speakers from AFCM, the one who voiced it the strongest to me, he voices it every so often, he said, I am so thrilled when I come to your church. He says, because you still believe in speaking in tongues. You'll still pull it out there. Rich Apfel, one of our missionaries, he hasn't been here for a while, but he said it too. He said, do you know how many, of course he went to college with me of that denomination, Assembly of God. He said, do you know how many Assembly of God churches I go to that there is, it's not they don't do it, it's not allowed, period. And AFCM, same thing. You can't go there and do this kind of stuff. They'll never invite you back. Because we don't want to offend the unlearned. This is important because if we try not to offend them and we see the strong stance the Holy Spirit took on this, we're going to offend him. So which one do we want to take a chance on here? If God's good with it, I should be good with it. And if the ignoramus is not, well, just see it for what it is. They don't get it. But aren't we supposed to reach them? Yes, but we're supposed to reach them with the full message. Amen. Yes. Not just pull the piece that is acceptable to everybody. The full message. And again, the reason this is important is we're backing off. And from my experience, the people who try to belittle, you know, speaking tongues, messaging tongues, that whole thing, are the same ones who try to posture themselves as the knowledgeable, learned ones. See, we're the ones who are against it. We're the ones who understand this. You guys are the ignoramuses, the ones who babble and speak in tongues. You're the idiots. Well, in reality, God went out of his way to reverse that in Scripture and say, don't miss this. It's not the people who speak in tongues who are the idiots, it's the ones who are against it. Wow. That's what I said. Wow. So here's my second point I want to make on the whole thought. Because people don't understand speaking in tongues, because there's been so much teaching against it, and we don't want to scare or offend people and drive them away from the church because a lot of times we're not sure ourselves what we should believe. Speaking in tongues has become an all or nothing in the church setting. And all or nothing, they're both in the ditch. They're both out of balance. Well, we either really go after it And it's like a badge of spirituality we wear. We want to make a statement to the world how spiritual and godly we are. So we overdo it, or we don't do it at all, and we don't allow it at all because whatever reasons we tie to that, all or nothing. And both are wrong.
Yep, amen. That's right.
Because we haven't clearly understood God's posture on the whole subject, we've either cowered back or we've kind of rebelled against it, and in our own arrogance and pride, we go overboard with it. We don't want to do that. We don't want to do that. We want to be as balanced as we can. Point number three, the people who don't believe in speaking in tongues, the people who teach against it, don't understand it, who won't come to Word of Life because we do speak in tongues. I've had people say, you know how many people I could bring to the church except for that speaking in tongues thing? If you would just drop that, I would come, and there's so many friends, we love that. We love how you teach, we love things you say, but when you get on this Holy Spirit thing and speaking in tongues, I ain't coming to that because I don't believe it, okay? And then they'll start quoting to me things they've heard, they've been taught, whatever, because, see, they're the learned ones, the ones who know. We're the messed up ones, the ones who don't understand. And as a result, from my knowledge, most denominational full gospel churches, now not everybody, but most of them at this point in our culture in America have backed off the gifts of the Spirit being in operation on a Sunday morning service, especially speaking in tongues. It's not allowed. We've postured ourselves like a fundamental denomination who doesn't believe in the fullness of the Holy Spirit and Him manifesting. That's why people from mainline denominations who don't believe in the Holy Spirit and Him manifesting can come into our services and be so comfortable and just sit there, even though we believe it, we're not living it. We're just like the mainstream church with a little bit more souped up music and, you know. And we do that, and I'm talking not just us, I'm talking the movement. We do that. We rule the Holy Spirit and speaking tongues and the gifts of the Spirit. We rule them out, not allowed, because they're offensive and they're confusing, and God should have thought this through before He ever came up with this. Of course, we don't say that, but we think that. So we relegate it to a Wednesday night or a Bible study or a certain group in the prayer room will work with you on this. But publicly, we don't do this. And we're growing as a, you know, as churches. When we stopped doing that Holy Spirit thing, man, we started getting all kinds of people, and we think that's proof that what we just did is right. See, all kinds of people are coming now. They wouldn't be coming if we kept doing that other thing. So that proves we're right. No, really doesn't. Doesn't prove you're right any more than Al-Qaeda or ISIS recruiting from Minneapolis and young people go over and help fight for their cause, proves they're right. Well, we've got all kinds of people coming into ISIS and switching to Islam, and man, we're growing like mad. We must be right. No. Right? Okay. So just because a church grows doesn't mean they're doing what's right in God's sight. You can't measure it by that. In fact, Paul directly announced that to Timothy. He said, don't confuse gain with godliness. Gain does not prove godliness. I mean, he flat out told Timothy that. Watch out for that. So we have to be careful of that. But in reality, if you want to look at from God's perspective, when we water the thing down and we don't take a stand for what His Word says, we are actually doing them in injustice, and we're misleading them. Why? Because those who don't have the baptism in the Holy Spirit with its gifts are supposed to receive it, and they're supposed to learn about it and be able to grow in it. But instead, because we don't handle it correctly, they back away from it and they don't learn what's right. Because many times we don't even know what's right. And that's why we get intimidated when the subject gets brought up. And someone comes to us and says, you guys actually do that there? Yeah? Wow, you're one of those churches? And we kind of, inside, you've all gone through it. You've all gone through the feeling of, oh, man, I hope we're right. And what if we're wrong? And what do I tell this person? And da, 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 da. And in 1 Corinthians 14, God specifically says, take the posture, they're an idiot. That's not a put-down. Please remember that. That's not a put-down. They are extremely unlearned, foolish, and unaware in this area. That's all. They're not bad people. They're not dumb people. They can be very intelligent. They just haven't learned about it yet. So take that posture. Don't cower down and go, oh, okay, if it's all right, we'll talk to the pastor and see if we can switch this whole thing. Don't do that. Just take the posture of they don't get it. Don't back away. They just don't get it. You say, why else would have God done this? Well, I got one more point here I want to throw in. See, now you're going to find now you're finding out why we can't get to the reasons to speak in tongues this morning, because I knew if I took this on, I would have to go really slowly and hit it strongly. And I decided to do that. So one more point concerning this. Why would God take such a strong stand on this issue? It is specific. It's not the Holy Spirit he's taking a strong stand on, even though in some places he does. I'm going to give you a verse that deals with that. It's not the gifts of the Spirit he's taking such a strong stand on. In 1 Corinthians 14, he's taking a strong stand on speaking in tongues. Why would he do that? I mean, to the point of using that word. Well, maybe he knew that in our day, it would get to the point where people would say, speaking in tongues and this whole thing's of the devil. And he wanted to give a very strong warning, don't go there. Remember, again, in the early church, when they read these letters, they knew exactly when the person reading, because they didn't all have Bibles, Paul would send them a letter, and the person would speak and read it to everybody. And when he read the word, and he said, and when people come in from the outside who are idiotes, they knew exactly what that meant. We don't, but they did. They knew God was taking a really strong stance here. Maybe God saw, as time goes on, let's give them the benefit of the doubt here, that people were going to start calling speaking in tongues demonic, of the devil. And he wanted a strong statement saying, no, don't go there, because you're the ones who are actually off. Case in point, the article we had looked at, Tongues Have Ceased, the 47 reasons, I'll read three of them to you. Bible tongues were assigned to confirm the speaker. Today's babbling does not confirm anything but possible devil possession. Number 32, the Bible tongues could not be easily duplicated. Third full sentence. But modern babbling and gibberish are easily duplicated through demons. Point 47, the conclusion point to the whole matter. It is easy to see that today speaking in tongues is an ungodly deception of the devil. It's demonic. Jump down to underline there. The doctrine and practice of charismatics and Pentecostals prove them to be heretics and under the delusion of the devil. Knowing that was coming concerning a gift he had given to the human race, God made a big statement. Because I'll tell you what, that's a big statement. And God didn't want it going there. Here's why that statement is so frightening. Those three points I pulled out of there. If that's not the unpardonable sin, it's so stinking close to it that it should scare your socks off. And I'll just read you the verse for that. It's Matthew 22:22-32. They brought a demon-possessed man to Jesus, and Jesus healed them, and all the people were astonished. But when the Pharisees heard this, they said, it is only by Beelzebub, the prince of demons, that Jesus, this fellow, drives out demons. Jesus knew their thoughts, and he refutes them a little bit. He said, a kingdom divided against itself can't stand. Satan can't be casting himself out. He said, if I'm driving demons out by Beelzebub, which is a prince demon, so then who do your people drive them out by? They'll be your judges. They don't drive them out by Beelzebub, neither am I. Verse 28, but if I drive out demons by the Spirit of God, yeah. then the kingdom of God has come upon you. What were they doing? They were attributing something the Holy Spirit was doing to the devil. That was their whole point. Yeah, well, he's casting out demons. Well, yeah, he's doing it. That's devil's power he's using. And Jesus said, wait, back up here. This is the Spirit of God's power I'm doing this by. So they were attributing what the Spirit of God was doing to the devil. The conclusion of that, verse 30, he who is not with me is against me, he who does not gather with me scatters. And so I tell you, every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven men, but the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven. What's he talking about? He's warning them. You are borderlining on a sin that is unforgivable. The sin is attributing to the devil what the Spirit of God or the Holy Spirit is doing. Verse 32, anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven, but anyone who speaks against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven either in this age or the next. What age to come? So it's a big issue. That's why I took that long dwell on it. So now let's finish the chapter. So be careful with how you use that and how you think about that. Because I don't want anybody going out of here and calling people who don't understand the Holy Spirit idiots. Because in our culture, that carries a whole different meaning than Paul and the Holy Spirit meant. And it's not going to help our cause. Pastor said, you people are a bunch of idiots. It's like, please don't do that. Okay? Send them to YouTube, send them online, let them listen to these couple messages and give me a chance to explain what the Scripture is saying. So here's the big question. Well, if that's what happens, the unlearned come in and they don't get it, what's going on? How does the church, specifically, he's still dealing with the speaker, how do they handle that? Chapter 14, verse 14, 5a said he wants everybody to speak in tongues. First part of verse 5 said he wants everybody to speak in tongues. Verse 13, he said in a group setting, the person who speaks in tongues as the speaker should pray there's an interpretation. Verse 15, he asks the question, so what do we do? We're supposed to do it. We're supposed to pray in tongues, supposed to sing in tongues with our mind. It's not an all or nothing, so what do? As the speaker who is trying to instruct others, we need to bring them revelation, knowledge, prophecy, word of instruction. If all we do is speak in tongues, this will cause problems. I mean, that makes sense. So here's what Paul says to do. Verse 16, if you are praising God with your spirit, and this we've read before, but let's get a running start. So if you're speaking in tongues praising God, how can anyone who finds himself among those who do not understand say amen to what you're thanksgiving? Amen means I agree, so be it. They can't say I agree. They don't know what you're saying. Since he does not know what you are saying, you may be giving thanks well enough, but the other man's not edified. So there's the dilemma. There's the problem. Verse 18, I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. So speaking in tongues isn't wrong. But in the church, see, back to the church. In the church, I would rather speak 5 intelligible words to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. Like I said last week, when you come into someone's house and the garbage is still laying in the entry and they turn and they look at their teenage daughter or son and say, garbage? They don't have to explain to me. I already know they told that person to take the garbage out, and it's still laying there. That's why they said, take care of the garbage. Well, the same thing's true here. Verse 19, what were these people doing? You know, I'd rather speak 5 intelligible words to instruct someone than 10,000 words in a tongue. Well, what were they doing? They were walking around speaking in tongues all the time. Like it was some kind of spiritual thing. I mean, it doesn't take a lot to figure out. Why would Paul tell them to stop doing something if they weren't doing it? They were doing it. He didn't say, because you're doing this, and then give that verse. But he gave that verse, which tells us they were doing that. So verse 18, Paul is speaking about his private life, not in church. We know that because he says, but in the church. So verse 18, he says, in my private life, I speak in tongues more than all of you. But in the church, he's making a distinction. That's how we know verse 18 is one of the few verses that's talking about, your private life in this chapter. But he is, because he makes the distinction. But if you're the speaker instructor, notice, but in the church, I would rather speak five intelligible words to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. If you're the speaker, if you're the instructor, and it doesn't have to be just the person up here, like right now me, it could be after a service, and there's 10 people gathered around you, and you're talking about something, and you feel like you can speak into this and instruct something, the worst thing you could do right there is stand there and speak in tongues. Show them how spiritual you are. Use five intelligible words and give them something to take home and chew on, then they walk out going, that was awkward. That was weird. Follow my point? Okay. So verse 11, he said, we read this already, and I just am pointing something out here now, showing you he's talking about the speaker of the church. Verse 11, he said, if I do not grasp the meaning of what someone is saying, I'm a foreigner to the speaker. There's a tension on a person speaking here now. They're supposed to give four things: revelation, knowledge, prophecy, word of instruction. When you come to church, who's responsible for giving those four things to the congregation? Whoever is speaking. And it could be you before service, could be you after service, and you've got a group of people around you, they came up for prayer, and the Holy Spirit's prompting you to say, explain something to them before you pray for them, and you got 5, 10, 15 people there. You've just become the speaker. So now the worst thing you can do, according to what Paul is saying, stand there and speak in tongues to them and say, well, let me give you something here. Romo no shata tokame, and you go on for 5 minutes, say, okay, now let's pray. It's like, no. Give them something they can understand. Build them up. Edify the church. In verse 19, he reemphasized he's still dealing with the speaker of the church. But in the church, I would rather speak five intelligible words to instruct others. So just to make sure everybody gets it, I'm not trying to be redundant. Right now, out of all the people sitting here, who's doing the instructing? You're not. I am. That makes me the speaker. So when he says to instruct others, he's talking about the person doing the instructing, the speaker. So he's still on the same theme. The speaker in a church, if you're talking to people, do something that helps them. Verse number 20, brothers, stop thinking like children in regard with evil. Be infants, but in your thinking, be adults. In other words, think what's best for everybody else. Children tend to think about what's best for them. They're mature. They don't care if it hurt their friend's feelings because they took their candy bar and ate it on them. And their friend's sitting there crying, I don't care, I got candy bar out of the whole deal. Well, sometimes adults can act that same way. You know, we don't care how it affects other people as long as I feel good. Paul says, grow up. Basically what he's saying. Verse 21, in the law it is written, through men of strange tongues and through lips of foreigners I will speak to this people, but even then they will not listen to me, says the Lord. He pulled out an Old Testament verse there to verify his point here. Verse 22, tongues then are a sign not for believers but for unbelievers. So the point he's pulling out of verse 21 is unbelievers, read it again, through men of strange tongues and through lips of foreigners. They don't get the language. They don't understand it. I will speak to this people. And this is when Israel was in bondage. And he said, the people who took you captive are going to speak to you, and I'm going to speak through them to you, and you're not going to get it. So he used that picture for verse 22, says, to make this point. Tongues then are a sign, not for believers, but for unbelievers. Prophecy, however, is for believers, not for unbelievers. Tongues are a sign for the unbelievers. You know what's interesting? When someone is unsaved and they come to church and we speak in tongues, it doesn't bother them. It's the people who think they know who come to church and we do it really bothers them. But tongues are a sign for unbelievers. He's making the statement, he's making the case. The very people we're so concerned are going to come into the church, they're going to be offended, they're going to leave because they don't get it, are not the ones who get offended and leave. It's the ones who've had previous teaching saying, yeah, we know that this is not for today and it shouldn't be happening and da 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 da. And they are already saved and they already had previous teaching. They're the ones who get offended. But the unbeliever, somebody's not saved, I have yet. In fact, they'll come up after service. They'll, you know, if you need prayer, anybody kind of. I've had people come up who are not even born again, Steve, and they say, could you teach me that language you were praying in? I really like that. And you go a little deeper, and they haven't even accepted Jesus as Savior. But they liked it because tongues are a sign for unbelievers. There's something supernatural about it that intrigues them. It's not something to be ashamed of or hide. It intrigues them. But even in that, it can be overdone. Just because it's a sign to them doesn't mean we do it for the whole message. It can be overdone. Hence, verse 23. So if the whole church comes together and everyone speaks in tongues, some who do not understand or some unbelievers come in, there is the word I was looking for. Those who do not understand, King James there is unlearned. That's the word. Or some unbelievers come in, will they not say you're out of your mind? Absolutely they will. Why? Because it's wrong? No, because we overdid it. Notice how he says it. If the whole church comes together and everyone speaks in tongues. But yet he just previously said, well, when I'm in church, I'll sing in the Spirit and I'll sing with my language. And in verse 5, he said, I want everybody in church to speak in tongues. So what's he talking about? Don't overdo this. I mean, we can get together as a church and for 15 minutes, everybody has to stand and do their spiritual exercise. Let's all speak in tongues. He's going to think you're out of your mind. It's no longer a sign to them. Now you look like the idiot. This is a real important point. It's not all or nothing. It's learn when it's the right time. Learn when it's the right way. Do it there. Don't back away. Do it there. But it's not an all or nothing. Well, why would we do it? If there's a chance of them saying you're out of your mind, why would we do it? Go back to the previous verse. Because it's a sign for them. God said so. Okay? I just got loud because I'm trying to make sure nobody falls asleep on me. Okay? So don't overdo it. It's a sign to unbelievers. 1 Corinthians 14:22. Now, the reason we're supposed to speak in tongues. Tongues, then, are a sign not for believers, but for unbelievers. Prophecy, however, is for believers, not for unbelievers. Is for believers, not for unbelievers. Chapter 16, verse 17 of Mark, and these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name, they will drive out demons. They will speak in new tongues. It's something that's supposed to be doing. So I'm going to make an announcement right now so that when Kevin comes, I'm going to ask him to clip this part that I'm talking right now and include it in when we were talking about it in 1 Corinthians 14, because I want to explain it from a different way than I did then. I explained it one way then. Now I'm going to explain it from a different way, and I want this included. And when people are watching this DVD and they're going, well, he's wearing different clothes, and it's different now. Well, he clipped this and he put it in. But tongues are a sign for unbelievers. Now go back to the scripture. I want to show you something. Next screen should give us verse 24 and 25. But if an unbeliever or an ignoramus or someone who doesn't understand or someone who does not understand, unlearned, comes in while everybody's prophesying, prophecy is in our known language, he will be convinced by all that he is a sinner and will be judged by all, and the secrets of heart will be laid bare, for he will fall down and worship God, exclaiming, God is really among you. Now, most people, back up to the previous screen. Tongues is a sign not for believers, but for unbelievers. Then, verse 23, they interpret unbelievers the wrong way. They say, well, see, that's the unsaved. No, that's not the unsaved. And then verse 24 and 25, they say, well, see, Paul just canceled out what he said back there in verse 22, that tongues is a sign for unbelievers, because in verse 24, he says, if an unbeliever or someone comes in, doesn't understand, you should be prophesying to him. No. Paul did not just contradict himself and cancel it out. In fact, verses 24 and 25 add strength to his point of tongues is for unbelievers. This is how. If you are trying to bring some understanding to this person, they don't understand. Paul says, don't do it by speaking in tongues to them, and that's how you're going to explain it to them. If you're going to explain it to them, use a form of language they understand so the secrets of their hearts will be laid bare and they can go, oh, now I'm not an idiot anymore. I get it. That's what he's saying. So he's not saying, well, you know that part of tongues is for unbelievers. I'm just going to contradict that here. No, he's saying it is for unbelievers, but don't get weird. And when they come with a question, you answer them in your tongues. Speak to them in a language they get and explain it to them. So verse 24 and 25 actually make a stronger point for the fact that tongues is for unbelievers. The bad translation with the NIV really messes it up. Unlearned in King James is okay. They hit it better. But the whole idea is they don't get it and they need some understanding. Explain it to them in a language they get. Okay? However, tongues is still a sign for the unbeliever. He made that statement. He made it very plain. So here's the conclusion on it. If you're the speaker trying to instruct someone, don't do it in tongues. And as a congregation, even though we can speak in tongues in church, verse 5, and either though we can sing and pray in tongues in church, verse 14 through 17, don't overdo a good thing. It's not an all or nothing. All or nothing, both of those are wrong. It's about doing both. Mostly what edifies the church. Common language. But you can also do some tongue stuff. But the prevailing thought, the main motivation when we get together, for me as a speaker or if you get in a speaker situation, and the main motivation we get together as a congregation is so everybody can be built up when they leave. And part of that is having times when in the main service you actually hear someone speaking in tongues. And the person that might need it the most is the one who's never been to church before, but they're inquiring. They want to see what this is about, and they hear it, and something in them goes, wow, that's neat. They usually think it's Latin. I don't know a word of Latin, but they usually think it's Latin. And they go, wow, that's neat, and it grabs their attention. What do signs do? Slow down. Construction ahead. What's that sign for? Grab your attention. Get you thinking. That's what tongues are for. But don't overdo it. Okay. Verse 24, but if an unbeliever or someone who does not understand comes in while the body is prophesying, their language, they understand what's being said, he will be convinced, the unbeliever, this is the other spot where it uses the word idiotes or idiot, does not understand. The word understand there is describing the person who's not getting it. He will be convinced by all that he is a sinner and will be judged by all. And the secrets of his heart will be laid bare, so he will fall down and worship God, exclaiming, God is really among you. There's the whole point of church. Get people to God. But we want to get them to the fullness of God. Amen. And not protect God from the stupid decision God made to even give tongues to the human race. He didn't know what he was doing. Let's protect everybody from that. Who do we think we are? God knew exactly what he was doing. We're the ones who are the idiots. And he said that. And it's like, okay, I got the point. I hear you. Now, I've had this, and with this I end. Well, if this whole thing's going to be that technical, you know, I think we should just back away from it totally, because if it's going to be that technical, I don't know if I'm interested. Well, that's a very childish approach. Let me explain to you why. I'm sure glad that someone invented engines for cars. Do you know how technical an engine is? It's pretty technical. Could you fix it? Well, if it's going to be that technical, why are you even driving one? I'm sure glad somebody invented electricity. Electricity is a fairly technical thing. Can you explain how it's generated and how it's transmitted and how going through this little canister hanging on the pole, the voltage goes up or down, or you get all that? No, I don't get that. Then you shouldn't use it. It's too technical for you. We can talk about phones, we can talk about TVs, we can talk about computer chips, talk about all kinds of things. So if you're going to use the line of reasoning, well, if it's going to be that technical, I'm not sure we should do it, then you better take that all the way through in the rest of your life and apply it to everything that's technical that you don't understand. Or you're just making an excuse for this one and you're not paying attention to the rest, right? I'm sure glad that there were technical people who invented these things. Even if it's beyond me, I really enjoy electricity. Yeah. I like phones, and I'm glad I didn't walk here this morning. That technical engine, when I hit the key, it ran like it's supposed to. Amen. Amen. So Paul is not saying we should never speak in tongues. We went over some verses already. Let's look at the verses in the rest of the chapter. Verse 26, he says, when the church group comes together, there will be tongues and interpretation. There will be. It must be done in such a way to edify the whole church. He didn't say don't have it in church. He said it will be, so this is how you do it. Verse 26 through 28, if a speaker speaks to the church or group in tongues, there needs to be an interpretation. If there's no interpretation, here's what you do. You don't speak to the whole group in tongues and try to instruct them or bring them some kind of revelation or knowledge. But verse 39, he goes on, to make sure nobody misunderstands this, and I've never heard those naysayers who say, well, see, we shouldn't be doing it in church. I've never heard them quote this verse. Do not forbid speaking in tongues. Because that's what they do. They forbid it. You can't do it. Well, wait a second. What about the last, you know, Paul's trying to put a conclusion onto this whole thing that has gotten confusing for the Corinth church, and as a result, it's confusing for the rest of the church. And his last, one of the last points he makes is, by the way, if you just don't tell somebody they can't do it. Let them do it. Just try to teach them how to do it. He's not saying we shouldn't. He's saying there's a time and a way to do it. Verse 26 through 28, he says there's a correct way for the speaker who's giving the message to deal with it. In verse 29 through 33, he says there's a correct way to handle prophecies by the speaker as well. So this chapter, chapter 14, is not against speaking in tongues. It's against doing it in the wrong setting or for the wrong purposes. I'll repeat that. This chapter is not against speaking in tongues, like many have taught it is. It is not. It's against the wrong setting and the wrong purpose. Let me just give you an example of that in this chapter. This chapter is against speaking in tongues the wrong way. This chapter is against speaking in English the wrong way and for the wrong purpose. Look at these verses, 33 through 35. For God is not the God of disorder, but of peace. This is still chapter 14, as it is in all the congregation of the saints. Verse 34. Women should remain silent in the churches. So women shouldn't speak in English in church. Well, you say, well, that ain't right. Well, I know it's not right. But it's in the same chapter. Paul's not against women speaking in English in church. What is he against? They're not allowed to speak. They must be in submission as the law says. Okay? So he's making a really strong point, and now he's telling us why he made that point. If they want to inquire about something, they're asking questions. They should ask their husbands or their own husbands at home, for it's disgraceful for a woman to speak in church. Oh, so what was going on? Some of you who are old enough understand this. I bet Isaac and Cease remember this. Remember years ago, the men sat on one side and the women sat on the other? Do you remember that, those days? I remember. I was a little guy. It ended when I was a little guy in our church. But when I was little, we had two sections. It wasn't set up like this. You come, you had the middle aisle, side aisles. There were two sections. And all the women sat over here and all the men sat over there. They kept them separate. I don't know why. I asked why. And, you know, sometimes you just told, don't ask about it. Talk about that. It's like, Well, I want to know. I never got a good answer. I've read things, and I'm not sure if it's right. I don't know why they sat separately, but they sat separately. It was some kind of sign of holiness. If you go to an Amish church or a Mennonite church today, they still do it. The women sit on one side, men sit on the other. Okay? So you got Steve over here, and you got Rhonda over there. And Rhonda's listening to what I'm saying, and she wants to inquire about something. So while I'm talking or while things are going on, Rhonda's over here and says, "Hey, Steve, what's he saying? I ain't getting it." And Steve goes, "Quiet, quiet, I'll tell you. No, I'm serious. I want to know what's going on." If they want to inquire about something, they should ask their husbands at home. "Wait till I get home, I'll tell you." It is disgraceful for a woman to speak in church. And there's people who've taken that and just pulled that one thing out of the... Again, look at it. He doesn't explain, well, there was this going on. What he explains is, if you want to ask a question in church, don't do it. Wait till you get home, because it's disgraceful. This is not good church conduct. You say, well, why is that disgraceful? Because they weren't sitting side by side like Ralph and Barbar. And she could lean over and go, "Hey, Ralph, Ralph." And nobody else knows. They were sitting in separate sections. Keep your mouth shut till you get home. I mean, stop and think about it. You got 15 women over here talking to their husbands over here while the speaker is trying to say something. That don't work. So Paul is against speaking English in our culture, in church. No. He's against speaking in English when you do it the wrong way. And that's one of the verses that a lot of people have quit going to church over, because there's churches out there who have actually tried to enforce that and say women should never say anything in church. Be quiet and stay in submission. I could reach back into chapter 14, pull a word out. Idiots. It's like, you're unlearned. You're not getting it. You're very elementary in that subject. Paul's not saying that. There's places in the New Testament women did a lot of speaking in church. Phoebe was a deaconess in the church. They had women who were prophets in the church or prophetesses. I mean, had women spoke in church. He's saying, if you want to ask a question, since one group is sitting here, and they knew all this. Oh, yeah, that's right, we're sitting separate. You think that could cause a problem? Yes, I think that could cause a problem. Be quiet and talk about it at home. That's what he's trying to say. So if you want to, you know, go with, well, Paul's against speaking in tongues in church, well, he's against speaking in English in church too. And that's just as dumb. Women, when you come to church, close the mouth at the door, and we don't want to hear a peep out of you until you leave. And I've had women say, well, why do I go? That's a very good question. Why would you go? You can't even praise God. You can't sing a song because it's disgraceful for you to say anything in church. That's stupid. It's just... And verse 39 of 40, end of the chapter, "Therefore, my brothers, be eager to prophesy and do not forbid speaking in tongues. But everything should be done in a fitting and orderly way." Absolutely, I'm in 100% agreement. 20 out of the 40 verses in this chapter emphasize the public good needs to be accomplished above personal good being accomplished when we're in church. Half the verses emphasize when we're in church, this is about the group, not about us. And making us the most important thing. Amen. And that can be done, and still you can speak in tongues in church. Yes. So hopefully I brought some clarity to that. It's a hard chapter, but it's only hard because we've been told things we shouldn't have been told. So next Sunday, thank you, Jesus. I'm so looking forward to giving you reasons why we should speak in tongues. There's just so many. We'll never be able to cover them all. There's so many. And they're so good. And I am trying to inspire you. Be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Let the Lord give you that spirit language. Operate in that spirit language. Use it on and on and on, daily basis. Use it, because it does so much in our life if we let it. And next week we're going to talk about the things it does. So Lord, thank you for bringing clarity to this. I pray in Jesus' name I didn't say it in such a way that anybody's offended or I shoved anybody away. I just tried to say what your word says. So Lord, I pray that everything's good and that we learned and we grew from it, number one. And number two, that we don't do anything stupid and dumb now and offend people by the wrong use of the knowledge we just gained. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Have an